Today, we're talking about one of the most famous fossils of its age, a giant armour-plated fish like nothing alive today. The year is 1867, when hotel owner and amateur paleontologist Jay Terrell is out searching for fossils in Ohio, in the northeast United States. He is about to make a discovery, bones from a giant prehistoric fish, likely to be one of the first vertebrates to fill the spot of apex predator. Terrell donated the fossils to paleontologist John Newbery at the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, who in 1875 described and named the animal Deinicthys terrelli in honor of its discoverer. This didn't stick though. Many decades later, another paleontologist called Jean-Pierre Lehmann recognized that Terrell's fossil fish and several other similar species didn't really fit the bracket that Newbery had originally assigned them to. He reassigned them to a new genus, Dunkleosteus, the name these animals still carry today. Dunkleosteus is a genus of around 10 species, belonging to a now extinct group called placoderms, meaning plated skin. Placoderms belong here with this group Arthrodira, the cousins of all the other fish groups that are still alive today, including us. Yes, we're technically fish, maybe more on that another time. The name placoderm comes from their most distinctive feature, the bony armoured plates that covered their heads and body trunk. In Dunkleosteus, these plates formed sharp cutting edges around the mouth, through which the animal could have exerted a huge bite force for catching prey. Along with its large size, this led to the conclusion that Dunkleosteus was an apex predator in the oceans of its time. But here we come to some controversy. Even though the iconic face armor and mouth plates of the animal are very well known to us and well preserved in 3D as fossils, most of the rest of the skeleton was made of cartilage, which doesn't preserve anywhere near as commonly or as clearly as bone does. Even today, after 150 years since the initial discovery of the animal, most of the back half of its anatomy is still not clearly known to us. And this has led to a lot of, inaccurate reconstructions over the years. Long and thin-bodied reconstructions with a more shark-like shape aren't really supported by current evidence, and a shorter, chunkier shape is more likely. Something like this, from a recent paper that reviewed the current evidence, is probably more like it. Besides the specifics of anatomy and body shape, the overall size of the animal has also been contested. Now, I think the wider public perception is that this animal was absolutely gigantic, and some of the earlier estimates that have been published and circulated go as high as 10 meters long. That's roughly double the size of the average great white shark, and about twice as tall as a giraffe. Meanwhile, the lower end of estimates go as low as about 4.5 meters long. That's less than half the length of the higher estimates. So just how big was Dunkleosteus? To work this out, researchers had to make comparisons between Dunkleosteus and other more completely preserved fossil fishes, as well as modern fishes that we know more about. Now, fishes tend to have very strong correlations between the sizes and proportions of different parts of their anatomy, particularly between the relative sizes of their head and their body. Now, statistical testing of this commonly accepted wisdom shows a very strong positive correlation between the length of the head and the total length of the body. And this is where Dunkleosteus's iconic head armor comes into play. While lots of its cartilage skeleton isn't known to us, we do have enough parts preserved to accurately reconstruct the size of Dunkleosteus's head. We can then use the statistical model to reverse engineer its overall size. The model was able to predict the sizes of modern fish to within a 17% margin of error. Now that might sound like a really big margin of error to some of you watching, but in paleontology that's actually really good. When the model was applied to data gathered from fossils of Dunkleosteus terrelli, the largest species in the genus, we get a size of around 3.4 meters for average sized adults, or just over 4 meters for the very biggest individuals. That means those earlier 10 meter long reconstructions are probably far too big, and that when we compare them to these new estimates, it probably looks something like this. This isn't as impressive as the earlier, probably inaccurate estimates, and makes Dunkleosteus much smaller than some other famous extinct fossil fishes, like say, Megalodon. But it's still really big, and not something you'd want to come across if you went out surfing. Now, remember, Megalodon lived over 300 million years after Dunkleosteus. These animals were not coexisting with each other. Tiktaalik, on the other hand, one of the first vertebrates capable of walking on land, was roughly contemporary with Dunkleosteus, living at around the same time in the late Devonian era. So, we've established that this allegedly giant fossil fish is probably much smaller than people thought. And earlier, I told you that this may have been one of the first ever vertebrate apex predators. But do we really know that that's true? Does this new evidence about the size and shape of the animal change that in any way? Let's run through what we know about how this animal lived its life. Dunkleosteus lived in the oceans of the Devonian era, where it's known from a roughly 30 million year stretch, right near the end of the era, just before the end-Devonian mass extinction. Geological evidence from the Cleveland Shale rock formation in Ohio, where Dunkleosteus was first discovered by J. Terrell in the 1860s, gives us our first clues as to how it lived. The type of rock, as well as the other animals found fossilized in it, paint a picture of open, deep water, likely with an anoxic bottom, that couldn't have supported much life on the seabed. This shows that Dunkleosteus probably lived in the open ocean, where it would have swam actively through the water column, staying well away from the seabed, where there would have been very little prey for it to hunt. The technical term for this is a nectonic pelagic cruiser. As with most things Dunkleosteus, though, there is some contention and controversy over just how good of a swimmer it would have actually been. Some more recent research presented a reconstruction of Dunkleosteus, the one I showed you earlier, with a shorter, stockier body shape, with an inflexible front half and strong musculature around its armoured plates. This might suggest that it wasn't a very agile swimmer, as it would have had a very stiff body, and that is the opposite of the longer, more flexible body shapes that are often associated with agile swimming in some sharks. Although, a counterpoint to this is that a shorter, deeper body shape brings more of the animal's weight closer to its center of gravity, and that is also associated with both high speeds and maneuverability in some other types of modern fish. In fact, these other types of modern fish might turn out to be a very useful model for understanding Dunkleosteus. Assuming that Dunkleosteus's body was stiffened by its armor plating and fusion of certain parts of the skeleton in its front half, it probably had to generate propulsion purely by moving the back half of its body, basically just by flapping its tail instead of being able to move its entire body. This style of swimming is called tuniform swimming, named for fish like tuna that swim this way today. Animals like that are capable of moving quickly for very long distances, and at very high speeds in short bursts when hunting. Atlantic bluefin tuna have been recorded at speeds upwards of 70 kilometers per hour, and assuming that Dunkleosteus has a similar body size, shape, and swimming style to tuna, we see this picture painted of an active swimmer of the ancient oceans, capable of both short sprints and long pursuits of its prey. Combine this with the very fast and powerful bite that it could have exerted through its blade-like mouth armor, and we reach the conclusion of a voracious apex predator. In fact, biomechanical analysis of the well-preserved head armor of Dunkleosteus shows that it might have had one of the strongest bite forces of any animal ever. Other fossils that are found in the same rocks as Dunkleosteus include things like sharks and ammonoids, classic components of many prehistoric marine ecosystems, and also arthropods, the group that crustaceans and insects belong to. Many of these would have been either highly mobile, or would have had thick exoskeletons or shells to defend themselves, which the strong and sharp bite of Dunkleosteus would have been well adapted to break through. And with nothing else really present at the time that could have preyed on Dunkleosteus, we're left again with that title of apex predator. Despite being one of the most famous and best-known fossils of its time, there's been a lot of contention and controversy around the biology of Dunkleosteus. I've done my best here to try and present to you some of the more recent findings that contest some of those long-standing and probably exaggerated claims that have found their way into public attention, things like it having an absolutely enormous size. But also to try and show you some of the clearer-cut conclusions, like its near-undeniable predatory lifestyle. I hope that you've enjoyed the video, and if you have, you can maybe watch this one that I made, well, the very first video I ever made on this channel about coelacanths. If you do, you can click on the video card up there, and I will also leave a link in the description along with all of the references that I used to make this video. Thank you for your time, and I hope to see you again soon.